Hello everyone. First of all, I would like to congratulate the conference organizing team for organizing a conference on action research in higher education in Sri Lanka, and also thank them for inviting me to give this talk. So in this talk, I'm going to talk about critical reflection for action research, pandemic and beyond. In this talk, I'm going to address four different issues. One is action research in higher education, and then I will talk about reflective practice for action research, challenges brought by the pandemic, and reflective practice in the digital age. First of all, let's look at action research in higher education. Why do we do action research in higher education, and why is it important in higher education sector? So when it comes to higher education, we have to think about conceptual contribution that we make to the society. For example, we as higher education sector, we should promote larger scale social changes. Also, we should be able to challenge injustice, and we need to work closely with the community in eradicating unequal economic and power relations. Now, these broader concepts can be achieved by looking at what we already do. Are we doing enough to achieve these goals? So we need to reflect on the current practices in order to see whether or how far we have achieved the community expected outcomes. Then action research is important in order to develop the institutions that we work for. So we should be able to challenge the traditional scholarship, research, and also administration and organization. We should be able to do this by doing action research, participatory action research. Through this, we can promote institutional change. When it comes to more narrower aspects like curriculum, so we can identify different strategies of developing, revising curriculum, and also how to widen participation when designing and implementing curriculum. When it comes to pedagogy, action research will help us to understand critical pedagogy and how to introduce innovative teaching. Not only that, we also need to think about professional development at university level. So that can also be achieved through action research projects by giving opportunities for individuals and groups to develop their professional practices. Also, action research will help us to understand how to upgrade services offered by the university, and it will help us to understand research better because action research will make us engage in research projects while doing our job, while engaging in our day-to-day activities, day-to-day academic activities. So it gives an opportunity for us to understand research better. So those are the broader areas that we can look at when we think of why action research is important in higher education, and what things or what areas that we can focus on when designing action research projects at university level. Now, when it comes to action research, reflective practice is one of the important steps of action research. We can perhaps say that's the first step of action research. We need to reflect upon what we have been doing in order to identify the issues that we face in our academic life. For example, we may be using some assessment techniques, but have we reflected upon what we are doing, what we have been doing, and have we analyzed the outcomes? Have we looked at whether the assessment techniques we are using are actually helpful for learners. So these things need to be addressed in action research projects, and for that, reflective practice is the starting point. So what is reflection? Reflection is active, persistent, and careful consideration of any belief. So it's not just the actions we do. We can also reflect upon our beliefs. What do we believe about pedagogy? What do we believe about classroom practices? What do we believe about research? So we can also reflect upon our beliefs, our knowledge. What do we already know? Is it sufficient enough? Do we need to update our knowledge? So likewise, we can also reflect upon our knowledge and also our practices. So we can reflect upon beliefs, knowledge, practices, values, our actions, based on the context that we work, based on the society that we live in, based on what is expected from us by the community. So reflection is not limited to just what we do at classroom level or an activity that we use in our lectures. It's a broader concept. It's also reflecting upon our beliefs, values, and attitudes as well. So who is a reflective teacher? A reflective teacher has three main qualities. The first one is open-mindedness. In other words, a reflective teacher is open to suggestions, innovative ideas, even suggestions from students, outsiders, any innovative ideas that people bring into class. A reflective teacher should be observing others and should be interested in researching pedagogical practices. The second quality is wholeheartedness. We also call this thinking teacher, and a thinking teacher is constantly seeking of techniques and materials, thinking before using and thinking after using. Anything, any concepts, any techniques, any pedagogical approaches, practices, curriculum. So a thinking teacher is always thinking what he or she is doing at classroom level or at a broader level at the university. And the third quality is responsibility, that is taking responsibility of what happens in the classroom. So yes, we take responsibility of delivering lectures, delivering the curriculum content. Probably we take responsibility of the assessments, but our responsibility does not stop there. Our responsibility is broader than that. So are we addressing the needs of the students? Are we addressing the community needs? Are we addressing the larger society's needs? So responsibility is one of the qualities that is expected from a teacher, and especially that is visible among reflective teachers. So what is actually reflective practice? That's basically we need to pause and think back. We need to, so we have been doing several things in our career, in our academic life, and we need to take, sometimes we need to think back, we need to pause and think back and ask questions. So what have we been doing all this time? Whatever the things we have done, are they successful? And why something happened? Why, how did we do something? Was it successful? When? So there are a lot of questions we need to ask about our own practices, our own beliefs, our own values. So that's where reflection starts. So pausing and thinking back is what we basically mean by reflecting. This can be done on three occasions: reflection in action, reflection on action, and reflection for action. Reflection in action is we can reflect on things happening when the action is taking place. In other words, in the teaching learning process, we can reflect on the daily activities that we conduct, daily experiences we have. So, reflection in action. Reflection on action is reflecting after an action, looking at what happened after an action. For example, we deliver courses, and at the end of the course, we can reflect upon what happened. We can question the whole process, what happened, what's successful, what was unsuccessful. So that's reflection on action. And the third is reflection for action. That is, even before implementing an action, even before implementing or starting our job, our teaching, we reflect. We reflect and predict what questions may arise, what challenges we may face, what success that we may be able to achieve. So there are three ways that we can reflect: a reflection in action, reflection on action, and reflection for action. So is this enough? Just asking, so what happened? Was it successful? Was it unsuccessful? What went well? What went wrong? So is this enough? Now here we need to think about critical reflection. Now critical reflection, if you look at the quotation here, any society that values creativity also needs to enable criticism. So this is an important concept. So criticism, we should be open to criticism. We may have put a lot of effort in planning our lessons, planning the curriculum, planning assessment, marking, but we also should be able to be critical of our practices. Then only creativity will be encouraged. If we look at our practices critically, without just looking at the surface level good and bad points, we need to be critical of our own practices to encourage creativity. So, if we do not do this, then we will not be open to new thoughts, and we will not be able to ways in which we can do the same thing in a different, more productive way. So, when it comes to critical reflection, so it's self-criticism is also important, as well as enabling criticism and accepting criticism from outsiders, your colleagues, students. So that should also be there, and we should be open to criticisms, and we should be able to reflect critically in order to achieve a productive outcome, or in order to plan something more successful in future. A broader view of critical reflection includes reflecting in depth and breadth. Like I explained earlier, in depth means looking beyond the surface level good and bad things, looking beyond that, and bringing in experiences, examples from other contexts, other countries, also looking at assumptions, thoughts, feelings, and values. Usually in a surface level reflection, we look at activities or curriculum, the content, and see whether that is suitable or not. But a broader level of critical reflection includes our assumptions. We assume that the students will be able to do this, or students will not be able to do this. So, are these assumptions accurate? Are they correct? Are they fair? And also our thoughts, our feelings, our values. So these should also be questioned, or we should be critical of these things as well. When it comes to breadth, going beyond our job duties or our main job responsibilities and looking at power relations, discrimination, oppression, issues like that. So critical reflection of our own practices does not really mean looking at surface level, looking at our curriculum and day-to-day practices at a surface level, but it goes beyond that and looking at our overall perceptions, assumptions, and the universities or our jobs relationship with outside community. So that type of reflection is needed in order to promote change or in order to promote creativity in whatever we do. What should be the focus of reflection? So there can be so many different things that we can reflect upon, but this diagram shows some of the things that we can focus on. For example, our subject knowledge, then our pedagogical knowledge, our pedagogical practices, beliefs about teaching, our knowledge of learners. What do we know about our learners and their characteristics? And then in the middle, you can see personal constructs and identity. So we need, like we discussed earlier, like I mentioned earlier, our assumptions, our values, our attitudes, our personal contribution to the teaching learning process. We need to reflect upon that as well. So is our contribution sufficient enough? What are we contributing? And how my attitudes affect the teaching learning process. So those things are also important, as well as curriculum knowledge. So for example, key skills associated with subject matter, additional curriculum frameworks influence, also acknowledgement of educational values, knowledge of learning settings, knowledge of values, those things are also important apart from our personal understanding of personal values and assumptions. And finally, pedagogic enactment in the classroom. So at classroom level also, we have several practices, so we need to reflect upon that. So reflection ranges from very minor classroom practices, for example, how we group students, and to a very broader social aspects, such as how we contribute to the social development in the society that we live in. So the reflections should be covering all these aspects when it comes to when we think of reflection at university level. Let's move on to challenges brought by the pandemic. Now, that has given us new avenues to work on. We have been probably we have been reflecting upon our practices, but pandemic has brought new challenges, and we need to think what's coming up in future as well. So some of the challenges brought by the pandemic to the higher education community are, so we had to transit from traditional face-to-face learning to remote learning, and we had to change the traditional curriculum to fit an online environment. We needed to get used to technology, for example, learning management systems and various other online tools. There have been operational changes. And several different social issues have been created because of the pandemic and also the remote learning option, mental health issues, maintaining equity and diversity. So all these challenges are there now due to the pandemic, and the challenges probably are very different to the challenges we had before the pandemic. So, when it comes to critical reflection, there are new things that we need to reflect upon. So we need to understand that our credibility has been questioned, whether we like it or not. The society community are questioning our credibility. For example, we knew that there is a digital age and everything is going way more digital than we expect we used to be, but were we prepared to face the digital age? So this is something we can question, we can reflect upon. So we had we there was a transformation of face-to-face curriculum to the digital version, online version, but were we prepared to face that? And is the transition successful? Is the online curriculum delivery successful? And has the quality been maintained? Have we addressed the issue of diversity and inclusion? So these things the society questions, and also we need to reflect upon these things. So we have new venue for critical reflection because of the pandemic. So when it comes to reflective practice in the digital age, the tools that we can use for reflective practice has also been changed. So they have been there for a long time, but probably we haven't used them so often because we were so used to the face-to-face teaching, face-to-face delivery of curriculum, and our reflective practices also probably happened using more traditional methods. But because of the pandemic, because of the way that we use digital tools nowadays, we can think of reflective practice in the digital age and what we can use. So one of the examples is audio video journaling, which is keeping audio video records of the daily practices and reflections. In other words, we are just recording without writing anything in our books. We just keep a record of daily reflections online or in our phone, and also do small videos on what happened in our classes. So likewise, audio video journaling is becoming popular, and this is not something new. For example, in Lakshmi's 2012 study, they noticed that they used video journaling, and then they noticed emerging patterns and themes relevant to participants' conceptualization of the use of reflective practice in classrooms. So this is one of the tools that we can use nowadays. Another tool is Webfolios. It is a digitized collection of artifacts, including demonstration, resources, accomplishments that represent an individual, group, organization, or institution. So this is where we can collect our reflections and have kind of a portfolio. It's called Webfolios because there are a lot of web portfolio tools available online, so it's easy because we use digital content for curriculum delivery now, so it's easy to maintain web folios. So in one of the studies, Ona and Adana Dunn demonstrated that they found out that teachers demonstrated high and low level reflective skills when using web folios. E-reflection tools such as e-books and Padlets are you we can use them these platforms as individual or collaborative tools for critical reflection, and also there is evidence that teachers are likely to have more personalized content in using such e-reflection tools. And also these are easy to use, easy to maintain, and one of the good things about this is that you have a record, unlike on piece of paper. You have a record of things that happened, your reflections, bits and pieces, and it's easy to find information when you have to, for example, if you're running a course, You can collect reflections on a Padlet, and then at the end of the course, you will have a collection of information, collection of good practices, issues, challenges, which will be useful for you to reflect upon what you have done. And finally, blogging and podcasting, that is sharing thoughts online through audio recording and writing. There are a lot of teacher blogs, reflective practice blogs that teachers use online. There are some of them are freely available, and this also we can do individually or in collaboration, both blogging and podcasting. In some research, people have shown that it saves time, immediacy in contact with the practice teacher, develop more confidence and skills in using web-based technology. So there are some benefits of using blogging and podcasting as reflective tools. So what we have discussed so far is why it is important to do action research at university level, and how reflective practice would encourage us to think of our practices, what we need to change, what's going on well, and also it gives an opportunity for us to question our own beliefs, values, practices, and it gives another opportunity for us to think whether we are doing what the community needs us to do, whether the broader society or the country needs us to do. And also it gives an opportunity for us to think of new avenues. Critical reflection would encourage innovation and a more wider participation in the teaching learning process. And then we also discussed the challenges brought by the pandemic and why critical reflection is even more influential or important in the current age, because a situation is created that we mostly deliver our curriculum via online tools, and we do not sometimes see our students face to face for a long time. And then we need to think whether the things we are doing are useful, whether that promotes teaching and learning, who are our students, are we maintaining equity and inclusion. So all these new challenges are there, and then it's important to reflect on these things in order for us to do a better job. So for that, again, reflection is important, as well as I introduce some of the e-tools that we can use in order to maintain our reflective journals or our reflections in a more accessible and more productive way. So we need to understand that we are in a new normal situation, and so we need to think new in order to face the future challenges. And thank you very much for listening. And these are the references that I have used in this presentation. Thank you very much.